So, Russian, Polish, and Norwegian. Lots of fun, right? Can anyone give me words that you know that are from either Russian or Polish or Norwegian? Yeah? No? Anything. Anything is good. Yes. I'm sorry? Pusta. Yes. Ah, kapusta. Okay. Yeah? Babushka. Yeah.
Alyosha.
Alyosha. Yeah. Let's take my hand.
Russian, Polish, and Norwegian.
So, just a quick communication survey. How many of you guys got my email that I sent out earlier today? Yeah? Okay, good. So that's some of you. That's good, that means it's at least working. I had a note in there about the meaning of the word Norwegian. Not really the meaning of the word itself, but what I meant by Norwegian. Do you guys remember? No? Alright. So basically, I've said Norwegian, but it's actually a whole bunch of other languages, not just Norwegian. So I'm going to have Norwegian and many other Scandinavian languages that are associated in the area. So, you guys ready to start?
Okay.
I need more vigorous nodding.
Yeah.
Yes, question.
The air conditioning is blowing really loudly. Mm-hmm.
Bring closer and be louder.
Yeah.
Got it. I will do so. Louder. Awesome. So, you guys have seen this language tree before, right?
Yes.
Yes, okay. Oh, it's not showing the language tree. That's wonderful. That's because I'm in the wrong place. Now, you see the language tree. The amazing tree of languages that we have seen before. So, Russian. Anyone point out Russian on the map? Look with your eyes and you can find Russian. I found it. Can you find it? Yeah, where is it? Yeah, right below Old Slavic. You have Russian. And by Russian, what's the other language?
Polish,
good. And what were the first two languages in the name of this entire workshop?
Russian and Polish.
Russian and Polish, good, awesome. And you might notice that the other one, Norwegian, is a little bit farther away. It's on the other side, it's on the left side. Do you know where it is? Yeah?
It's by Icelandic.
Yes, it's by Icelandic. So we have Norwegian and Icelandic and Faroese, which is different, but it's from a slightly different area. So these are all West Norse languages from the North Germanic branch of eventually Germanic. We talked about Germanic languages, right?
Yes.
And we talked about how, interestingly enough, languages like German are actually somewhat related to languages like Sanskrit because they share a whole bunch of Indo-European roots. But we're going to cover Norwegian, a little bit of Icelandic, and some languages like Swedish and Danish sharing their North Germanic branches. But before all of that, we have Russian. So, when you hear the word Russian, what kind of stuff do you see or think about? Yeah?
Moscow.
Moscow, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Music, yeah. Yes. Yes, babushka dolls. So, we have matryoshka dolls over there, and some globes. There is Russia in the blue, and some various other Russian areas. You have very colorful, interesting architecture, and the Transiberian Railroad. This one. Does anyone know what their writing system is called? Yes. Yes, awesome. So, Cyrillic, let's actually find out how it's spelled. Who knows how it's spelled? Yeah, go ahead.
Is it C-Y-R-I-L-L-I-C?
Close. So it's actually C-Y-R-I-L-L-I-C. Cyrillic. Some say it was created after Saint Cyril. Some attribute the characters to it. And we can go ahead and start Russian. So, how do you say that sound? Ah. For those of you that don't know, the A with the two dots on top of it makes the ah sound. So, some words that have the ah sound. To begin with, the word buron. Is there anyone who's a space geek out there? We're right by NASA, yeah. So, fun fact, buron is also the name for the Russian space shuttle program, or was the name. It got shut down. Kind of like ours before. So Buran, a northeasterly wind of gale force in Russia and Central Asia. It's kind of straightforward. There's a bur, that's a B-U-R. The U is a U. And then the on is just an A and an N. Buron. Right? And then right after that, it's a bit more complicated. Sometimes in Russian, you see these letters like the Z. So, who can say this word? Yeah. So there's a Som, S-A with the two dots and an M. And then there's an E with the dash on top of it. So that's an E. And that, with the Z, makes the sound Samis. And then after that, you have a dot. All put together, it is Samis dot. Good. So, Samis dot means a system of censorship, kind of, and then black market printing and distributing of literature. It's a very useful spelling word. And then right after that is another word, a Russian unit of length equal to 7 feet. How do you say that word? Sazhen. So, there's a sa and there's zhen. And with all of these, they have the ah sound, right? What's another sound that the two later words have? And at the very beginning? There's a sa. One interesting thing about the last word. Can you notice? Yeah, the G is pretty tricky. So right over here, it's a G, which is weird considering there's a Z. You'd expect it, like I said, to have a Z, but this one actually has a G for the Z sound. The one right before that just has a Z, not a Z, and that one has a Z. So this one I think is kind of tricky. Over there are two words that are special because contrary to having an A for the A sound, they actually have more of an A sound instead of an A. Buron, droshky. A droshky, what do you think it is? There's a picture of it.
Carriage?
Yeah, a carriage. It's a four-wheeled open carriage. And what would you think it would be pulled by?
A horse.
Yeah, probably. So you have a droshky, and then below that, what's that thing? Yeah, what do you think it would be used for?
Music.
Amazing, you would use a thing that looks kind of like a guitar for playing music. Not called a guitar, it's a domra, right? D-O-M-R-A. Domra. Yeah. Not too complicated. Now, this one over here. Lezginka. So a lezginka means a courtship dance of the Caucasus Mountains. It's a fun word to spell, because there's a les with an L-E-Z, and then a G-I-N-K-A. Ginka. Fun fact. Do you guys know any plants or trees that sound kind of like the second part of that word? Yeah? Yes. And how do you spell that? Yes. G-I-N-K-G-O. So, fun word. It's not from Russian, but it's good nonetheless. G-I-N-K-G-O. And the second part of the word in the genus name is myloba. This is actually a really cool tree. It's one of the older trees that are existing in the world today. They're actually really useful for people who are looking at global warming over the millennia. Because ginkgo biloba, right over there, is a really old tree. So it's been on the earth for a really long time. And in different time periods, if they find fossils of ginkgo biloba, it's really interesting because the number of pores on the leaves, because you guys know that leaves exchange gases with the air, right? So what gas do they take in?
Carbon dioxide.
Yes, and what gas do they put out?
Oxygen.
So if you have 10 holes, right, and they're all pulling in carbon dioxide, if you have more carbon dioxide in the air, would you need less holes or more holes? Less holes for the same amount of carbon dioxide. So by looking at fossils of ginkgo biloba, they can tell how much carbon dioxide was in the atmosphere by looking at the number of pores on the leaves. That's really cool. Okay, let's get back to Russian. So, taking departure from Chinese plants, let's go to Russian people. Fyodor Dostoevsky, and characteristic of his writing, there is Dostoevsky. So, can you guys see the spelling of his last name?
Yeah.
How is it spelled?
D-O-S-T-O-E-V-S-K-Y.
Yes, D-O-S-T-O-E-V-S-K-Y, right? What happened when it became an adjective?
Yeah, it is I-A-N.
Yeah. So, exactly. It got rid of the Y and turned it into an I. And then it got an A and an N added to the very end of it. So the A and the N show up in a whole bunch of adjectives, especially when you adjectivize them to create a word in English. So, yeah. So the A and the N are the adjective suffix, and before that is just his name, Dostoevsky. One interesting thing that happens in Russian is that sometimes when you have a vowel combination like the O and the E, instead of being like an O or a E, it's a Ye. So Dostoevsky, not just Dostoevsky. Does that kind of make sense? Alright. And then right on the right side, it's kind of hard to see, but can you guys see what the thing is trying to show, the picture?
Yes.
What is it?
A mole that's sleeping.
Yeah, it's a mole rat. So, slepets, in Russian, originally means blind one. Because moles are...
Blind.
Blind, yeah. So most moles can't really see because they're just digging under the ground. Slepes. S-L-E-P-E-Z. Fun fact, what other language did we have where the Z kind of makes a z sound instead of a z? Spanish doesn't usually have this Z. How do you say the circular thing of dough with toppings?
Pizza.
Yeah.
Italian.
Yeah, and do you say pizza or pizza?
Pizza.
Pizza. So a T and an S sound for the Z. So it's not always that way, but just in this word, you have a slepets, and that makes the ts sound for the Z. And then up here, the Nepmen, one of a group of small private traders. One part of this word is more English than Russian. Can you guess what it is? Man, yeah. It's a person that does something, right? So a Nepmen, it's a group of private traders and merchants. The more Russian part of it is a Nep. And how would you spell Nep?
N-E-P.
Yeah. How do you spell Nap?
N-E-P.
Yay. Who likes naps? I love naps. Okay. Now, what sound is at the very top?
E.
The E sound. And this is a particularly fun word at the left, I think. Can you try saying that one? Belina, yeah, so if you actually look at the pronunciation symbols over here, there's the upside down E with a dot on top of it, like I was mentioning earlier. So that one makes a very short I sound, so it's a bit. And then after that, there's an L. And then an E with the line on top of it, just like the one at the very top of the slide, and a N. So, Belina, right? Yeah. So, a Belina is a Russian folk epic or ballad, kind of like the one that's depicted in the picture. So this one, for the I sound, has a Y. For the E sound, it has an I. Another word with an I for the E sound is Safia. What's another word that kind of sounds like that, but
sapphire.
That's not Russian? There's sapphire and saffron. So how do you spell those two words?
Sapphire.
Okay, one at a time. So who can spell sapphire? Yeah. Close. So it's actually, yeah?
S-A-P-P-H-I-R-E.
Yeah. S-A-P-P-H-I-R-E. Figure. Yeah. And what about saffron? Yes. Yeah. Yeah. So saffron is S-A-F-F-R-O-N. Saffron. Neither of those are Russian, interestingly enough, but the Russian word is Safian, a leather made of goatskins or sheepskins, tanned with sumac, and dyed with bright colors. You guys remember we did the word sumac, right?
No.
I did it before. And then over there, at the bottom right, that's a fun little animal. What is it?
Sea cat.
A tiger weasel. So it's like a weasel, and it starts off looking kind of like a skunk, and then becomes like a leopard or a tiger, and then ends up with like a skunk. So it's fun. It's a tiger weasel. So, let's break it up into chunks. What kind of chunks, even though they're not actual prefixes and suffixes, could you kind of break this word up into to help you spell? Yeah, so just sound it out, right? Per, wit, ski. Right. So how would you spell per?
P-E-R-P-E-R.
Yeah, so it's kind of tricky. In this case, it's P-E-R. And then how do you spell wit?
W-I-T.
Right. So W-I-T for wit. And then in Russian, the sound ski kind of shows up sometimes. Instead of being like the stuff you do on the snow, on the mountain, it's actually S-K-Y for the ski sound. So you have Hrwitski, right? What's another word that you just saw that had another ski? It was a name. Dostoevsky, yes. So if you go back and look at the guy's name, Dostoevsky, that has an S-K-Y at the end, right? Dostoevsky, Hrwitski, and S-K, oop, I scrolled, and S-K-Y. And then up there, that word actually doesn't look very Russian. That word looks kind of like a combination of English words, because there's like see and catch. If you see something and you catch it, that's not always a sea catch. So a sea catch is actually a grown male Alaskan fur seal. And that's why there's a seal over there, looking at you with his flippers on the ground. A lot of fun.
It looks weird.
What about this one? What is this animal?
A horse.
Yes, it's a Russian breed of trotting horses. Orlov. Orlov. There's an or, an O-R, and an L-O-F-F. A lof, right? It's kind of like laugh, but not spelled like laugh at all. This one has an L-O-F-F. Give me another word that has an O-F-F at the end.
Stroganoff.
Yeah. So right there, to the right side of Orlov, is the word Stroganoff. And that one also happens to have an O-F-F. Is it purely coincidence? Oh, that's horrible. But yeah, Stroganoff. So the definition of Stroganoff is cooked in a sauce of sour cream, mustard, onion, and condiments, used postpositively, named after Count Paul Stroganoff, a 19th century Russian diplomat. So that one also happens to come from some guy's name. The word on the right, I really like, because that one is actually not pronounced the way it looks. Does anyone read the pronunciation symbols first? Want to know how it's spelled? Think about it. I'll give you a couple seconds. It's broken up into three syllables. At first, there's a chair. So it's CH. What sound does the CH make?
Sure.
Sure. And then there's an E, not a schwa. So what sound does an E make? Eh. So the E makes the eh sound. And then you have an R, so that makes the chair sound, right? It's kind of like a chair, but not an A, it's an E. And then there's an N and a schwa. What sound does that make? No. So the schwa, the upside down E, is an U. So you have chur, no. And then right after that is a zyom. Z-Y-O with a dot. That makes the A sound. And then an M. Cherna zyom. What does the spelling look like it would sound? Chernozem, right? Just Chernozem. But it's actually pronounced Chernozyom. I think this word is a lot of fun. Chernozyom. Yeah. And it's kind of hard to see from the picture, but what do you think the picture is trying to show?
A bunch of dirt.
A bunch of dirt, yeah. So Chernozyom means any of a group of dark-colored soils with a deep, rich humus horizon found in regions like the Glasslands would be really interesting if you had like a bunch of dirt that was just glass. What I mean is grasslands, found in Central North America, also known as North America. And what do you do when you have very fertile soil?
Plant stuff.
Exactly. We as humans like planting stuff and growing stuff, usually so we can eat them later on. Yeah, that's why if you go to the Midwest, you see a whole bunch of corn. Amazing. So, Chernozyom. This one is a bit simpler. What is this named after? Hint, it says it in the definition.
Pavlov.
Yeah. A Russian physiologist, Ivan Pavlov. And what did Pavlov do? Does anyone know? Something with dogs. Yeah. For any people that are interested in things like classical and operant conditioning, he did the experiment where, you know, he gave food to dogs. And whenever it was time for them to eat, he rang a bell. And eventually, if he rang a bell without food, the dogs started salivating because they eventually associated the sound of the bell with the presence of food. And they were like, wow, it's food time! Even though there was no food in front of them because they heard the bell. So that was Mr. Ivan Pavlov, and after that, we got the word Pavlovian, or Pavlovian. So, what did I say was the adjective ending?
I-A-N.
Yeah, I-A-N. Sometimes just the A-N, but usually like an I-A-N. And what did I get added to? To Pavlov, which was the guy's name. Yeah. So you have the guy's name, and then the I-A-N that makes it an adjective ending, and that's how you end up with this seemingly complicated word that actually now makes a whole bunch of sense. Right? It kind of does. I mean, if you take into account that it's just his name, right? And you know, just like, just his name, okay, Pavlov. And then Ian, it's an adjective. Yeah. Yeah. A bit slightly more complicated than Pavlovian is Lysenkoism. So that one is another of the words that, when you look at it, you might think, Lysenkoism. But it's actually not that, it's Lysenkoism. So, first, this is an L and a schwa, which makes the sound L. And then there's a apostrophe-looking thing, which is, what is that? The stress, the primary stress. And then an S and an E, and an N with the weird thing that hangs off, right? Which makes the sound the eng. Yeah. Yeah.
All of the words,
they both have primary stresses, and in fact, all of the words on the page have primary stresses. So, Orlov has a primary stress behind the O, Bogatyr has a primary stress behind the T, Pavlovian has it behind the L, Stroganov has it behind the S, Cherezyom, those actually look like colons, right? They're just dashed colons. That is because the dictionary is trying to say that you can swap the stresses. You can either have the secondary stress first and the primary stress later, or the primary stress first and the secondary stress later. So it can be pronounced either Cherezyom or Cherezyom. So when you ask for alternate pronunciations, the pronouncer is going to be like, you're going to make me sound out stresses now. Cherezyom or Cherezyom. Yeah. And that, we end up with the word Lysenkoism, which means a biological doctrine asserting the, can you read the rest of it? Yeah. It's a long, kind of complicated definition that basically means, you know, when you had the guy Mendel and his pea plants, that's not everything that matters in determining the color of the pea plant. Yeah, it's a simple explanation. Lysenkoism. But it's a good spelling. Yes?
That Cherezyom, is that the same thing as in the German you told us, Wiesengoden? Is that the same exact definition?
It's very close. So Wiesengoden, actually, and I can actually pull it up right now and show you. Here we go. Oh, because that clearly shows the definition right there. So this is Wiesenboden. Any of an intrazonal group of dark brown to black meadow soils rich in organic matter with great... You can see the very intricate, boring definition. Sometimes the dictionary does that. It gives us, like, amazing, long definitions. What's really fun about the dictionary, I think, is it gives the word that it's related to. So you can realize, if you read a little bit, that the word Wiesenboden actually comes from, or is related to, the words ooze and bottom. So it's basically like muddy ooze that is at the bottom of the soil, is kind of how they got the word. But Wiesenboden, so that's like the long definition. It's similar to, but slightly different than I click it, yeah. And this is Cherezyom, da-da-da. Yeah. And you have a group of dark-colored zonal soils that be, yeah. You can read the definition. So it's like, kind of similar, but different. Yeah. This is slightly different. Yeah. So particularly this one is developed through poor drainage in humid regions, is Wiesenboden. And Cherezyom develops in temperate to cool climate. So in like different areas. They won't make you differentiate between that even if they ask you for like vocabulary. Yet most of them are gonna be like, is it talking about a chair or dirt? And you say, it's talking about dirt. Awesome, you got it. Yeah, they're basically dirt. Wiesenboden comes from what language? Yes, awesome. And Cherezyom? It comes from the dirt. No, it comes from Russian. So, And Bogatyr. Who can think what Bogatyr means?
Knight?
Yeah, kind of, pretty much. So, Bogatyr means one of the legendary medieval heroes of Russia.
Yeah.
Legendary. That's why they're wearing armor and on horses, so they can look like Thor. What mythology is Thor from?
Norse
mythology, yes. And we'll get to that in a little bit. So, the oo sound, right? You have a kulak. A kulak is a prosperous or wealthy peasant farmer. You have the gudok, which is a what?
Violin.
Another musical instrument, yeah. It has a bow, it's kind of like a violin, but a more different violin. Yeah. And then you have a shuba. And what does a shuba look like?
A coat.
Yeah, it's a fur-lined coat. And then you have a saiga. I find this a really weird animal.
Saiga?
Yeah, it's like a deer, but then the nose started looking like a taper. You guys know what tapers are, right?
No.
And how do you spell taper?
T-A-P-I-R.
Yeah, they're fun animals too, but their noses still kind of look like they belong to them. T-A-P-I-R. This one, it's really funny. And then there is a balalaika. You guys have seen that, spell it, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. And then there's a nagaika, which is a thick, tightly twisted whip used by the Cossacks. So basically, yeah. Question. Let's check. I suspect it is not, but I can always confirm for you. So Arapaima is actually New Latin from Portuguese and Spanish, from Tupi, from various other South American languages. So yeah, it's not really Russian, I'm just pulling it up to show you, but this is a much more complicated word that usually they won't ask at lower levels. Arapaima, because we had a wonderful question. Yes, this is New Latin from Portuguese and Tupi, not Russian. Different areas of the world, different languages too. So, takeaway from this is the I sound is spelled with what?
A-I.
Yeah, like what word? Taiga, I heard it. What is taiga? It's a biome, it's very cold, right? But it's below the...
Tundra.
Yes, awesome. We can go on, are you smarter than the fifth grader now? Because they asked that stuff. And then the oo is, amazingly... Yes, a U. Awesome. And we get to the schwa, the infamous sound, which makes you go, I don't know. But this instrument is yet another... Oh, I said it, an instrument. Fun. So this is a bandura. Contrary to Spanish, where you might be tempted to put in an extra R, this only has one, B-A-N-D-U-R-A. And then right to the right of this, I think those are kind of cool. A tokamak. Do you know what it does?
No.
Do you guys know how many states in matter there are?
No.
Three.
So what are they?
Liquids, solids.
So they're solids, liquids, and gases, right? And then depending on how weird you want to be, there's also bosonside condensates, and there are plasmas. And tokamaks are really useful because they can make plasmas. What it does is, this stuff that you see right here are basically magnetic coils, and they make super strong magnetic fields. So whenever you pump a little bit of like a gas in there, the magnetic fields make all of the atoms get really close together until they get super, super hot and they turn into this really weird thing that's called a plasma. Yeah. Awesome. Science tidbit of the day. Yeah?
For the shore sound of Russian, how do we determine the A, B, or U?
Good question. So, most of the time, we had a good question. The question was, in Russian, if you have a schwa, how do you determine if it's going to be an A, E, or a U? And the answer is, go by what you think it is, because usually you can figure it out. I believe in you. So, tokamak, right? What sound do you have? An uh. It would be kind of weird to put a U in there, right, and make it toku, like tofu. It's tokamak, and it would make most sense to put an A in there. Same thing with pavlova. Pavlova wouldn't really make sense with a U, or an E. But in a word like theremin, there, arguably you might think of putting an A or an E, but there's not an U. The place with a U is holoschik. H-O-L-L-U-S, holos, right? Does it kind of make sense? Yeah. So kind of just use your intuition and you'll figure it out. Pavlova, P-A-V-L-O-V-A. Interestingly enough, yeah, Does anyone know what Pavlova was named after?
Pavlovia.
This was actually not named after the guy who tested on dogs. This was named after a woman named Anna Pavlova, a Russian ballerina. Because the dessert is supposed to kind of look like a ballerina's tutu.
Yeah.
That's not my fault. Oh, but Chris tastes good. Anyway, there's purga, which is interesting. That word is very special. Contrary to like taiga, where you have an A-I-G-A, right? And the A-I, why do you have the A-I?
The
I sound, right? So tai, T-A-I. And then what's the consonant right after that?
G.
The G. And what's the sound after that? And a schwa, and you put an A in there. This one is special because you put an E. It's like the purge, but it's actually just the purga, an intense Arctic snowstorm. Maybe the first explorers who went to the Arctic were like, oh wow, it's the purge. But it's actually just the purga. And then right above that word is the theremin. Have you guys ever heard of that before?
No.
Yes, no? Yes. You move your hand up and down and it makes sound. It's really weird. And I'd heard the word, and I had no clue what it was for the longest time until I looked up on YouTube, and I was like, wow. So here is an amazing YouTube video, and this time I'm actually connected to the internet. So you can watch the video. Oh, and... yeah, Over the Rainbow from The Wizard of Oz. So I can actually skip forward to a part that actually sounds pretty cool. Moving his hand and it makes sound. He's not touching it. He's just moving his hand in the air and it makes sound. So this is kind of controlling the pitch and this is kind of the volume. But yeah, moving his hand it has the effect of vibrato like it would on like a violin or on other instruments. It's pretty cool, right? No, he's not. He kind of looks like he's blowing into his hand, but he's actually just looking down. Yeah. Now, more Russian words. The Pika. One might even consider that what was named after it.
Pikachu!
Yes, amazing. I find them so adorable. And we'll actually watch a video of one next. But yay, videos! But before that, we have to do words, guys. We're here for words, not Pika videos. Although they are quite amazing, I'll tell you. So, before that, another adjective with the what ending?
I-A-N.
It's like USA. But, and this time it's named after a guy named Anton Chekhov. So, Chekhovian, right? Yeah. So, Chekhovian has C-H-E-K-H-O-V because that's his name. He wrote plays and stories. So, Chekhovian describes like an adjective characteristic of his plays and stories. And that's how you got the word Chekhovian. Got it?
Yeah.
Alright. And then over here, you have Knez. And Knez, oh, don't go back to the purge. So Knez means a Slavic prince or duke. It's kind of like what a building toy? Knex. But it has nothing to do with Knex. That's just a fun little connection. K-N-E-Z, like K-N-E-X, but K-N-E-Z. Yeah, and then over right there, it looks like a little Apollo space module, but it's actually just a circular tent. It's a Kerrigan circular tent of latticework, or a Russian-covered vehicle on wheels and runners. This is known as the kibitka. Say that for me. Kibitka.
Kibitka.
Kibitka. Yeah. So, what sounds does it have? Break it up.
Kibitka.
Yeah, ki, bit, and ka. How do you think you would spell ki?
K-I.
K-I. What about bit?
B-I-T.
And ka?
K-A.
Yeah. Does kibitka sound like a really simple word or not?
Yes.
Now it does, now that you know how to spell it. So, and at the bottom, over here is a Stakhanovite, a worker in the USSR. Over here is a Baruchzi. It's a dog, and it has like really long fucking hair. But Baruchzi, Stakhanovite, both of them have KHs, which make them unique. in contrast to the other ones that just have K's. Chekhovian has a KH, his name also had a KH. And then over there, here, Chistka, a political purge. This time it's actually a purge and not a purga. Yeah. So primary stresses have to do with like how you say words, right? So most words, whenever you say them, there's a particular part that you stress over another one, right? So like a word like table, right? You say table, not table, or to play, right? So the primary stress basically tells you exactly where and how to say a word when you say it. Does that make sense? All right, cool. So you guys got these words?
Yeah.
The K sound. And now it is time for the pika. The American pika popping up. It's just wiggling its nose. And then it runs away. Okay, let's finish up Russian with the T sound, and then we get to go to Czech and Polish. So, a knout is a flogging whip with a lash of leather, thongs, twisted with wire for punishing criminals, so that's quite violent. But the part to know is the fact that it's an O-U-T like out, right? And at the beginning, like snout, except it has a K, and it's not knout, it's just knout. So the K kind of became silent, but it's still there nonetheless. Got it? And then after that, how would you say that?
Sterlet.
Sterlet. And they're famous because they make caviar. What is caviar?
Fish eggs.
Fish eggs, yeah. Caviar is fish eggs. So sterlet is a small sturgeon. What is a sturgeon? Yeah, using contest clues. A sturgeon is a fish. And what is a sterlet? A fish. Amazing. Okay. So sterlet is interesting because not like sturgeon, which is kind of like a surgeon, just with a T. The sterlet actually has an E instead of a U. That makes it kind of weird and special. Over there is a kaftan. What does the kaftan look like? Yeah. Yes. Question. Let's check. Let us check if it has a variant with a K. A variant of kaftan, and here you see the interesting thing about spelling bee. Sometimes there are multiple spellings to a word. And in the case that you spell the other spelling of the word, they should allow that. And if they don't, that is grounds for telling them. Yeah?
But then what's the word in the definition that makes sense?
The exact same. Yeah.
No, but it doesn't show.
Exactly. And the reason it doesn't show in this entry is because they felt it quite redundant to put it here when you could just go to the other one and see. So they don't want you to be lazy, they want to encourage physical exercise by flipping the pages. But here, we can just press our fingers. And we end up at kaftan. Yeah. So K-F-T-A-N is actually more accurate to the original Russian spelling, which came from Turkish, from Persian, which had a Q like Persian. Yeah, it's an ankle-length, coat-like garment. Thank you for putting that up. It's interesting things to know. Yes, you have a question? Interesting. Do you have an idea how it's spelled? The same spelling? If it has the same spelling, it's most probably the same word. Yes, there's no other entries for the same one. So it's just this. So the Arabic probably got it from Persian, or the other way around. It just doesn't show that for some reason. So kaftan in Arabic is the same thing, basically. Got it? Same thing. And over here is agitprop. Propaganda and agitation, especially in the head of communism. One might even consider that agitprop came from the two words, agitation and propaganda. It's actually coming from the Russian phrase, agitatsi propagandi, which are derived from the same places that the English words are. So yeah. Agitprop. Yeah. Yeah. So, we have more amazing fancy words for people that know amazing fancy words. And if I can press clear and type with one hand, there is an interesting word called agitpunkt, which means an indoctrination and political propaganda center in the Soviet Union. Yeah. from punkt, meaning point or place. Russian made it a P-U-N-K-T, which is interesting, because in other places you would have what spelling? P-U-N-C-T. Can you think of a word that has P-U-N-C-T?
Punctuation.
Yeah, punctuation, exactly, awesome job. So, yeah, and puncture, because they all come from punctuare to point. So if you're puncturing a balloon, what do you puncture it with?
Puncture.
Yeah, it's kind of hard to puncture it with your palm, so you puncture it with a needle, right? Because it has a point.
Wait, what's the difference between puncture and acupuncture?
So, puncture is just any, like, poking, right? Acupuncture is very specific because it's like poking you with needles to make you feel better and make your boo-boos go away. Yeah. It's kind of intuitive, but yeah. Alright, so that's the tea, and now we can go to Czech and Polish. And interestingly enough, the first word that we're going to do in Czech is the ha Czech. The ha Czech. Which is fun, because the C in ha Czech has the ha Czech on it. Do you guys get the self-defining definitions? So the word ha Czech has a C with the little circumflex on top of it. And the circumflex is called the ha Czech. Yes, amazing. Yeah, it's the inverted circumflex. Now we can go to a word like redowa. And a redowa is either of two popular Bohemian ballroom dances of the 19th century. Yeah, kind of like Bohemian Rhapsody, but not. And then right to the right of that is a word that you guys, being Estonians, might be very familiar with, although with a different spelling. Kolaches, right? And how do you normally see them spelled? K-O-L-A-C-H-E, kind of, yeah. So the actual Czech word is K-O-L-A-C-K-Y. Interesting thing, just like over here, how the C became like a ch sound, even if you don't have the ha Czech on the C, you can have the C making a ch sound, like this one, kolachki. Get it? Kolachki. K-Y. Just like Russian, sometimes you have the Y as the E sound. And that's how you get kolachki. The k sound is usually a k, like sokol. Remember, you're a member of various Slavic gymnastic societies. Over here is the word dumka, an Eastern European folk ballad with alternating slow and fast sections. And then below that is napropathy, therapeutic system of drugless treatment. Based on the fact that symptoms result from disorder in the ligaments and connective tissues. What are ligaments? Yeah, like the connections. Hopefully you don't get fractured. But what's another word that's kind of like ligament?
Tendon.
Oh, pigment. Good idea. They're actually not related, but they're similar sounding, right? Yeah. So what are pigments? They're dyes, they're colors, yeah. And how do you spell pigment?
P-I-G-M-E-N-T, good.
Sigmunds.
And Polish. So, this one is special because what sound would a D and a Z usually make? Z, right? But here, it does not make Z sound. It makes the J sound. So this word is actually Rengina, not Renzina. Rengina. Interestingly enough. They kind of got compressed and compressed and compressed until it was no longer Renzina, but rather Rengina. The rest of it is fine. Ren is an R-E-N, and then Ina is I-N-A. It's just the J in the middle. And then the word to the right side of that, what does that look like? But what does it look like?
Bread.
Yeah. Yeah, it looks like, it kind of looks like cinnamon. It looks like cinnamon bread, kind of. It's basically a glazed sweet bread made with dried fruit, like dried raisins. Which is kind of redundant because raisins are in essence dried grapes. So I don't know why I said dried raisins. Maybe they're like super dehydrated. But yeah. Oh, speaking of which, what do you guys have you ever opened like a new box of stuff and seen like these little white packets?
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah, with silica gel and it says do not eat.
Yes.
Right? Do you know what the term for that is? The other word that it says on the packet?
Excessive.
Close.
Yes.
Yes. So it's a desiccant. And how do you spell desiccant? Close. So I'll actually show you the actual spelling in the actual dictionary. We have D-E-S-I-C-C-A-N-T. Dun, dun, dun. Desiccant! And if we look at the other entry for a noun, because this one, a drying agent, as sulfuric acid, or as the packets say, silica gel. You would hope that it doesn't have sulfuric acid, otherwise it would go through all the other stuff, which would not be good. You don't want your stuff to be destroyed by sulfuric acid. Okay, just a fun fact, and let's put that on the board, because it's a really good word. Desiccant. It's tricky because of the S's and the C's. The C is double, the S is not. D, E, S, I, and then what comes after that?
C, C.
C, C, A, M, T. Desiccant. And it does what?
Dry
stuff out. Yeah, good. Yeah, so desiccate is the verb. That's the stuff that does it, and then desiccate would be the verb of to dry out. And it's also the stuff that, you put in your closet and it takes all the moisture, right? You might have seen it on TV. I forgot what it's called. Yeah, the stuff that absorbs moisture. And then over there has nothing to do with moisture. Well, this one kind of does. It's liquor. But Krakowiak over there, that is a dance. A Polish, usually group folk dance, which makes sense because there are multiple groups of people there. That combines elements of the ancient round, the more recent square, and various other things. Yeah.
Are there any other languages?
Yeah. So, I didn't hear the very end of it, but I think what you're saying is, like, different languages, do they still have roots, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. So basically, you made a good point that Afrikaans had roots, and it's kind of because Afrikaans comes from what language, guys?
Dutch.
And Dutch is related to what other language? German, right? Which is related to Latin. So all of these things, a whole bunch of the Indo-European languages basically have a whole bunch of roots, or at least root words that they're deriving, like, key parts from. And that carries through because Polish, right? Polish is related to Russian, which is related to the Indo-European branch, so it means it'll have some, at least some, of the root words. Does that make sense? Right. Yeah, and then over there is the Oberek. You can see that they do a whole lot of dancing because the Oberek is a Polish folk dance, yet another Polish folk dance, right? And then to the left of that is Zbrowka, a dry straw-colored vodka. And then to the left of that is the Grosz. And what does it look like? Yeah, it's just not a dollar, because they don't have dollars. It's a grosh. It's a 1 grosh coin. Amazing, that's why it even says grosh on it. And, that's in the Polish. And what language do we do next? Norwegian! Yay! And we go immediately to a plate full of cheese. So, let us answer your root question by making the assertion that a whole bunch of Norwegian words that have to do with cheeses end with the ending O-S-T. It's actually a lot of fun because I like looking up all the words that end in O-S-T and all of them are cheeses. So, O-S-T, dash for the suffix, and this is Norwegian equals cheese. Yay, cheese. You guys want to look up some of the other words?
Yes.
I heard one yes. Do I hear more yeses?
Yes.
Yeah, alright, so let's look up cheeses. And what we shall do is go over here, put in the entry word star OST, that means there's an OST at the very end, and etymology, or at least definition, contains cheese. Cheese. And let's search, and it'll think about it for a little bit. You don't see the ah. And let's look at the 5 words. There's Appetitist, this is Danish, from German, from Middle High German, from Old Norse, so it's the Germanic branch, right? And it means a soft Danish cheese made from sour buttermilk. So, what do you think the word itself comes from? Appetitist.
Appetite.
And Ost, which is cheese. So it's basically appetite cheese. And then the next word is Gammelost. So this one comes from gammel, meaning old, because they take this cheese and kind of make it hibernate during winter. It's basically blue cheese, so it has a whole bunch of mold on it. So, old cheese. Old cheese is mold cheese. Yes. Norwegian blue mold cheese made from sour skim milk. Yeah, they do. I actually looked it up, and it said that it was one of a staple, so that means they ate a lot. Except it's very hard to make, it takes a lot of time. So eventually they stopped making as much of it, and now it's like really hard to find outside of even Norway. So yeah. So, a long time ago, but not anymore. And then this one is fun, because there's a yay, there's a yuh sound, which happens to be a yay, but just like before how we had a J sound with a D and a Z, now we have a Y with a G and a J.
What?
Yeah. It's like gudjetost, right? But it's actually yetost, or yetost. A hard, dark brown cheese made of goat's milk, but sometimes a combination of cows and goat's milk. It comes from get, meaning goat. Get it? Get. So it's basically goat cheese. Yetost.
Yeah?
So, goat and oats meaning cheese, a hard dark brown cheese made of goat's milk. And then the fourth word over here, mysost, a hard brown cheese of mild flavor, made from whey, especially of goat's milk. From mice meaning whey, and then oats meaning?
Cheese.
Enthusiasm, cheese!
Cheese!
Yay, cheese! We're not taking pictures yet. Nickel. Now, well, this is interesting. So pronunciation symbols, right? This is one of the really weird ones. That's a schwa, an upside down E, with a macron over it. So you start out with an and you want to make it long. So what do you do? Various things. But it's basically Nikolost. A dark cheese made from whole or partly skimmed milk and spiced with cumin, caraway, or cloves, or all three. I like the side notes that the dictionary throws in. So they're like, spiced with cumin, caraway, or cloves, or all three. Amazing. So Nikol meaning key, from its being modeled after cheese from Holland, where they actually put keys to mark the cheese, so that they had like a stamp for the cheese. And they started making it in Norway too, and they're like, let's call it key cheese, because they put stamps on it. Yeah. And over here, you can look at a picture of the aforementioned Gammelost, which is known as the what cheese?
The bread cheese.
The old cheese, get it? Which I said is the mold cheese. But this is what it looks like bread. Yeah. And over there is Nikolost. And what was Nikolost? Nikolost was the one that was the spiced with cumin, caraway, cloves, or all three. And you can probably see the cumin, or caraway, or cloves, or all three over here in the cheese. And then up there, made famous by Pirates of the
Caribbean.
Amazing. Is the Kraken, right? K-R-A-K-E-N. Release the Kraken. Yeah. And over here is a whale known as the Rorqual. Say the word, guys.
Rorqual.
It's kind of weird. It's basically a whale. You're like, what? They just said whale. Well, they said Rorqual, and so we have the word Rorqual. R-O-R for roar. Qua is a Q-U, not a K. And then A-L. And then over here, oh, actually, do this. This one looks like tortillas, right? But it's actually tortillas. But it's actually a large, thin potato pancake served buttered and folded. Yeah. So kind of like tortillas, but not. Yeah. It's food, and it's probably good food too.
Yeah.
But then over there we have rosemaling, which is not food anymore. Rosemaling means painted or carved decoration consisting of floral and other designs. Got it? Yeah. So, some more words. Flow. You guys have heard the word flow, right? Maybe?
Yes.
Yeah. So when you have like an iceberg, and you have a chunk of an iceberg that breaks off, it turns into a
flow.
Yeah. Over here is a ski jarring. It's basically like the Alaskan Husky lap sledge race, except instead of like a pack of dogs, you have one. And he's like, yay, let's go for a walk. And you're like, all right, let me get my skis. And then it becomes a ski jarring, like that. And then you have krill. You guys have heard krill, right?
Yeah.
What animal eats krill?
A whale.
Yeah, and some other things too, but mostly whale in large quantities. Yeah, sometimes dolphins eat them. You had a question?
Yes.
No? Alright. Maybe afterwards. And then over here, a boy. I like using that in English class. I actually used it in 7th grade once, and my English teacher circled it in red pen. She's like, you misspelled boy, and I'm like, well, Let us see. Then I open the dictionary. A formless or pervasive obstacle. It's quite a useful word, actually. And it's quite a fun word, too. Boing! It's like boy, but boing! Right? It's like boing, right? It's bouncy. Almost. But usually obstacles or enemies aren't bouncy. Unless they're like the rabbit from the dog movie. Yeah, and over here is a fish. That looks like a fish, right?
Yes. It looks like a fish.
Yeah. And that is a Sveriges. Yes, it does. It looks like the Swedish fish, especially the fact that it's red, right? Yeah, and this is red too. And over here is a leaster. So a leaster is a barbed dart for whaling. That's bad, I'm gonna kill the whale. But yeah, leaster. Interesting to note because L-E-I, right? There is another word known as Leicester, which has to do with England, not Norway. But let's look that up because it's kind of weird and fun.
Is it Leicester like a name?
Yes, that's also another word, but that's not in the dictionary. Is it? Let's check. No, that's not in the dictionary. So Leicester, like the name, like Lester Holt, is not in the dictionary. But in the dictionary there is, oh, fun fact. You guys know how to say, how to spell Worcestershire, right?
Yes.
Possibly?
Yes.
Like the sauce. Yeah. Who hasn't tried spelling Worcestershire like the sauce?
Worcestershire?
Yeah, go ahead. Yeah. So Worcestershire. It looks really weird. Worcestershire, right? But a fun thing that happens is that usually Worcestershire becomes slightly less, more like Worcestershire, and becomes more, oh, they conveniently took it away. Yeah. It's not Worcester anymore, I can guarantee you that. And just like that, this is actually spelled L-E-I-C-E-S-T-E-R, and it's pronounced Lester, like Lester Holt, but it's not spelled like Lester Holt. It's L-E-I-C-E-S-T-E-R, of or from the city in England. Yeah. Or Leicestershire. Leicestershire. A lot of confusion. Anyway, this is Leicester, has an L-E-I and an S-T-E-R. Icelandic and Danish, we can finish up. So, you have like a Viking, but it's like Poseidon, except he kind of became a merman also. He still has a trident. But this is known as Marmennetla. Weird word, Icelandic. Oh, fun fact about Iceland. Does Iceland have a lot of ice?
Nope.
No.
What? That's
Greenland has a whole bunch of ice. Iceland has more green than Greenland. Yeah, I find it kind of funny. Yeah, so Marmennetla. It looks like what word?
Merman.
Yeah, so the male form of a mermaid is a merman. And this is kind of related to merman. It's just Marmen. It's like backwards. And then there's an N-I-L-L at the end, which is, interestingly enough, pronounced Nitla, not Nil. Yeah. Over there is a harpoon, you're familiar with that word, right?
Yeah.
And then behind that, or before that, is an Eyrir, another fun word. Icelandic has fun words. So, A is an E-Y, and the rear is an R-I-R. Eyrir. It's interesting. Over there is Jokul, J-O-K-U-L. What does Jokul mean? An Icelandic mountain covered with ice. And there's the volcano, Eyjafjallajökull, right? If you know. It was active, I forgot. Yeah. There's Eyjafjallajökull and various other Jokul words if you go to Google and search up Icelandic volcanoes. It's fun. Here is the word flens to strip a whale of blubber skin. Here, there's even a yogurt that's called that. Skyr. And it says Icelandic style yogurt. Skyr. It's like sky, but with an R at the end, right? And what's the word on top of that?
Glima.
And what does Glima look like the guy's doing? A wrestling technique in which you say no and flip the guy over the back. Yeah, so that's Glima, right? Oh, I should. I forgot that, sorry. Yeah, you can go home and find a video of Glima on yourself. Danish, more cheese. What is the cheese? It looks like a sponge, doesn't it? But it's actually cheese, yeah. If you try to turn that into a sponge, you'll have a hard time. You might be able to use that one as a sponge, though. That looks like ice cream, doesn't it?
No, but it looks like bread balls.
You would be right. It looks like bread, and it is indeed bread. And how do you say it?
Ablestu.
Ablestu? And interestingly enough, there's a schwa at the very end. So you thought you were done, but you're actually not. It's Ebleskiva. Ebleskiva. It's weird, and it's Ebleskiva. Yeah, so it's a bread. Havarti is a cheese. This one, what about this one? How do you say this? So two sounds with primary stress over there. How do you say this? Fi, and then an L, so fiel. It's actually not field, although it comes from field. F-J-E-L-D is very icy, a barren plateau of the Scandinavian upland. Below this one, we learned about this. What is O-S-T?
Cheese!
Awesome. And it comes from what?
Appetite!
Yeah.
Appetite
cheese. So soft dip, yep, appetite cheese. And over here is a toast to someone's health called Skol. S-K-O-A-L. It's like score, but actually S-K-O-A-L. Yeah. And then over there is a berry known as the bilberry. Get it? Bilberry. There's nothing to get, it's just a bilberry. Yeah, bilberry. And then right there we have another prime example of a what kind of adjective?
I-A-N.
An I-A-N adjective. And you might even guess it comes after a guy's name. What might the guy's name be? Yeah, from the Danish philosopher Søren Abye Kierkegaard. He died in 1855, so quite a little bit ago. But he was a Danish philosopher, and that's his face.
Yeah.
Kierkegaardian. Swedish. Like Swedish fish, right? But not. Swedish fish aren't really Swedish.
The owl is so pretty.
The owl is really pretty. It's a harfang. Har, F-H-A-R. And then fang, although the owl doesn't have a fang. It doesn't have fangs, so yeah. It comes from Old Swedish har, from hair. What is a hair?
A hair.
Like the turtle and the hare, right? And fang means to catch. So you could probably deduce that the owl catches hares. And then eats them, probably. Which is sad, but it's a really pretty owl nonetheless.
It's pretty.
Yeah. And then on the right side, remember, we did the dollars in Dutch. Right? We did Riksdaler in Dutch. And now we have the Swedish version, which is Riksdaler. Yay for Germanic, right?
Riksdaler.
Yeah. And then over here is Chaley. TJ makes the what sound? Ch. An AE for the A. And then a Lee is spelled with A.
What is the meaning of that?
So Chaley means frozen ground. Permanently frozen ground.
So it would never ever fall?
Yeah, it's that cold.
If you get a flamethrower.
Perhaps, yeah, if you get a flamethrower. Yeah. But over here is a smorgasbord, right? Yay! Shoveling food. Over here is a really pretty flower. I would call it hibiscus, but that's not a hibiscus. It's actually an alstroemeria. Yeah. It's like Astros, but it's actually Alstro. And T-R-O-E. And then M-E-R-I-A. Alstroemeria. Yay, flowers. Below that is a sievert. It's abbreviated as an SV, and is a standard charge for radioactivity. Not charge, why did I say charge? It's a standard unit for radioactivity. Yeah. When you eat a banana, it gives you radioactivity. It's fun.
What?
Adams! I just made you scared. There's nothing to be scared of. Eat bananas all you want. Well, not too many. Yeah. Bananas are perfectly awesome. Yeah. And then over to the right is the Desmond.
It looks like an anteater.
It does look kind of like an anteater, but it also is basically... Yeah, kind of like a platypus too, because it has like a little... But a Desmond is actually a mole that, instead of... Where do moles live?
On the ground.
Yeah, in the ground, right? They dig, dig, dig. And we said they're... what are moles?
Blind.
Blind, yeah.
Unseen. So,
oh, I actually clicked. So a Desmond is pretty much blind, but it goes into the water. So it lives in like a burrow by the water, kind of
so
like a beaver.
Not beaver,
so
here,
okay.
What do cats eat?
Rats?
Cats.
Cats?
They eat
other...
Like...
Mice?
No!
Rats?
No! No!
I'll let you think about that, yeah. So we can go on to this little slide about confusing stuff. Let's not look at the confusing stuff. Do you guys want to look at the confusing stuff or no?
Yes!
I hear yes as a no.
No, that's actually not.
Hey, if you don't want to look at the confusing words, you can just stare at the picture of the really cute squirrel. And in the meantime, I'll come over here and talk about the really confusing words. Rhea, Rhea, and Rhea. They're homonyms.
Rhea, Rhea.
Rhea, Rhea, and Rhea.
Rhea,
Saria over there means a rug.
So that's why you should ask the definition.
Precisely! Yay, round of applause. That's why you should ask for the definition. So you know exactly which word they're asking when you have no other way of telling which word they're asking. R-Y-A for rug. That's my mnemonic. Three letters in rug, three letters in Rhea. This bird, like an ostrich, is R-H-E-A. How many letters are in the word bird?
Four.
Bird is the word. There are four letters in bird. And there are four letters in Rhea. And over here, what is the river that we know of?
Rio.
The Rio Grande?
Rio Grande.
Yeah, and the place where the Olympics are being held?
Rio de Janeiro.
Yeah, so Rio means river, right? And over here, it's a small river. So when you take something and make it a diminutive in Spanish, it becomes an A. So we have Rio instead of Rio. Rio, big river. Rio, small river. Big river. Now you guys got Rio, Rio, and Rio?
Yeah.
And you should do what?
Ask for the definition.
Precisely. Yeah. Or language words. Yeah. Because Swedish knew Latin from Latin from Greek and Spanish. All right. Now, slightly more confusing. Sizzle, 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 and sizzle. Yeah. There's also sizzle, which is like what something does when you put it in the pan, right? How do you spell that?
S-I-Z-Z-L-E.
Yeah, so that goes on the board over here. S-I-Z-Z-L-E. Right? But, sizzle over there is a squirrel, right? The cute little squirrel. There's another word for that. It's called sislik.
Oh, no.
So sislik is actually S-U-S-L-I-K. S-U-S-L-I-K. So sislik is also another word for the same hardware. Squirrel. And then we have sisal, which is a whole bunch of fiber. Comes from plants. S-I-S-A-L. Over here is an Icelandic word from Danish from Icelandic. It's an Icelandic administrative district, S-Y-S-S-E-L. And then over here, what does it say?
Metal scrap.
S-C-I-S-S-E-L. Metal scrap cookies.
Like scissor.
Exactly, like scissor. So, how do you spell scissors?
S-C-I-S-S-L-R.
Yes, and I'm so glad you made that connection because they come from the same word. Scissors. The operative part of the word scissor is O-R, because O-R means something that does, right? And what does it do? S-C-I-S-S. And S-C-I-S-S means to cut. And so the stuff that ends up when you do the sissing, S-C-I-S-S, is the sissel, S-C-I-S-S-E-L.
It sounds like jingle.
Yeah, it sounds like jingle too.
Chisel.
Oh, yeah, and chisel. So how do you spell chisel?
C-H-I-S-E-L.
C-H-I-S-E-L, yeah. We went on a language trip. Awesome. So, we...
In
our favorite rocket ship. Amazing. So, next week is what?
The Spelling Bee.
The Spelling Bee. So, just a quick overview. In addition to the definition, you should ask for the language of origin, right?
Yes.
The part of speech.
Yes.
What is the part of speech?
Noun, verb, adjective,
that sort of stuff. And use it in a
sentence.
Oh, I can actually see the color change. Anyway, so this is spelling. You ask the questions. When you hear the word, before you spell it, what do you have to do?
Process.
Say it.
Say the word back to the pronouncer and the judges so they know that you heard the word. And if you heard it completely wrong, like they said table and you heard bell, they can say no, it's table, not bell. And
why
once you're done spelling, I'm sorry, what?
Why would you hear table but say it was bell?
I don't know, but it's good to be safe either way. Because if you do hear bell and you go out, then there's nothing they can do to help you, right? So, and then once you're done spelling, to make sure that they know that you're done spelling, what do you do?
Say the word.
Exactly. So you say it before you spell, spell the word, and then say it again after you're done spelling, right? All right. And one key thing to notice, if you stop in the middle of the word, right, can you start over?
Yes.
But what can you not do if you start over?
Change.
Exactly. So the letters that you've said, if you go back and start over, you can't change the letters that you said, all right? Awesome. So you guys get this? So, do you guys enjoy this workshop?
Yes.
Let us do the cheesing time, which is known as picture taking time. Group picture!